two things today. First of all, about the mission to the moon and Alina, which you can see behind me, and robots driving around the surface of the moon. First private moon mission. And about social media in space. This is something where Kate will tell you a little bit about it. And just from, you know, the order of things we thought that it might make sense to first introduce you a little bit to what we do with the mission to the moon. And then we talk about, you know, how social media, you know, can be really, really cool when it comes to space exploration. If I need to talk louder for you, you know, just give me like a sign.
Louder.
Oh my God. Okay, I'm not so good at screaming, but I'm going to try my best. Okay, so basically, what is the mission to the moon about? So the mission to the moon is that we take the spacecraft that we have here, and for the first time in the history of space exploration, we want to go back to a place where we've already been. So what you can see here, and I will hand it around a little, is kind of an image, and we can always like this, so we can kind of put this. So what it shows you is an image, it shows you like that we have a rover which will be driving towards the Apollo rover, and that is what we want to achieve. So we want to go back to the moon, and we want to really visit this rover that is being left behind by Apollo 17, you know, by the last mission of the Apollo program. And we want to understand what happened to it for 45 years. So that is kind of the overall mission goal. So maybe a little bit picture of the Apollo 17 rover and why it should be exciting. The Apollo 17 vehicle, the lunar rover over there, that was this little guy that the Apollo astronauts used to drive around on the surface of the moon. And it was a really, really big product of the 60s, so it was highly improvised back then. And they built it in like 6 months or so, so it was really quick. And it consists of a lot of materials that nobody would ever again kind of use in space, you know, like duct tape, plastic seats, piano wire, foils, nylon, you know. So that's kind of the things, you know, that if you ask somebody at NASA today, that they would be a little bit too scared to use this material. And it's kind of interesting to see what happened to it after 45 years. So we want to understand from the material science point of view what happened to this material. So what we started out doing is 9 years ago, I founded a team of scientists and engineers, which is called initially called the Countdown Scientists. You know, so people kind of doing science and research in their free time. Today, this initially was a group of 6 scientists and engineers. Today, we are a team of 35 scientists and engineers working here in Berlin, Germany, in this first private mission to the moon. And what we kind of achieved after 9 years of technical development is what you can see here, and also, of course, in the background, that's the spacecraft that we developed. It's the third generation of the spacecraft, so they're more than one prototype. It's not like one thing that you just build in a basement and then you have a spacecraft. It takes a lot of development. And then we have what we don't have with us today, the latest generation of the rover, which is the generation 4 model. This is the man, the guy over there. I can also send out this picture. So, and as part of this mission, Alina will be sent from, you know, from down here with a rocket all the way up to the upper Earth atmosphere. So, and then from there on does its transition towards the moon. So, you know, it goes around the Earth, you know, makes a few circles, going larger and larger from the point of view. And it makes the transit all the way to the moon. It makes a direct touchdown. That's kind of like the simple way of how to get to the moon. It's not as simple as it sounds, because in space there's always one important rule, and that is everything has to work, nothing is allowed to fail. Because the problem is, if you think about going to the moon, it's a travel of 400,000 kilometers. And on your transit phase, you know, the travel phase all the way over there, if something goes wrong, there's nobody there to help you. So you have to understand the top speeds that you reach when you travel towards the moon is 10.6 kilometers per second. That's a unit that you really have to think about. We're talking about kilometers per second, 10.6 kilometers per second. So this means that, for example, if there's just a slight calculation error, you will not have time to adjust quickly enough, you know, to not miss the moon or really hit it really hard. So that's both of the things that you don't want. And both of the things which have happened more than often in the last space missions. And so the point for us, of course, is to really make sure that everything works out in this case. There's a small graphic which kind of shows a little bit what the steps of the mission are. It kind of should compensate a little bit for having a presentation. So it shows you the basic steps, you know, of launching, getting to the moon. The most challenging part of this mission is once you get to the moon is actually the landing phase. So making sure that you do a safe touchdown. Because all that speed that you need to get to the moon, which takes about 5 days of flight, is something which you need to get rid of again. So you really need to, I don't know, do a braking maneuver. So you need to lose the speed and then touch down on the surface. And the problem is that you need to make sure that the area where you touch down is a very, you know, is a very soft one. There's not so many rocks and craters. That's one of the reasons why we choose Apollo 17. Because, you know, Apollo 17 has this rover that we want to analyze, but also because it's the most well-explored landing site of Apollo. So Apollo 17 was the only mission from the Apollo program that kind of really made sense, you know, from today's perspective. Because all the other missions were being done, you know, by fighter pilots, which is not a bad thing per se, but, you know, sending a fighter pilot like Neil Armstrong to the moon would be like sending me to the moon. You know, I couldn't tell you much more about this moon than he can. Like, other than it's a lot of fun to be there, that it's a nice, great place with a lot of great rocks. But that's kind of about it. And Apollo 17, they sent scientists, really geologists, so people who kind of just from the looking at things can understand much more about the environment. That is the reason why Apollo 17 is the most well-explored area. That's the reason why we know pretty well that there's a very high chance that we will not hit any rock when we touch down. Going back to Apollo 17 is not just interesting, but it's also the easiest target to reach on Moon for, you know, for private return. And you know, for a private mission like we do, you know, where we have to do everything on our own, it really means that we have to make it as easy as possible on the point of view. Because if you think about it, everybody can make it more complicated, but you know, you can never make it more simpler. And if you look, for example, at past space missions, you will see that, for example, the mission from the European Space Agency. Also called the Schiaparelli lander. How was the mission called? I'm not sure the name. The landing vehicle was Schiaparelli and the other one was, I don't know. Not Rosetta. Rosetta was the S1. I will talk about this in a second because there's also something interesting about it. No, the Schiaparelli was from Mars. So the mission that the European Space Agency did towards Mars, for example, was also a multi-billion dollar mission. But in the end, it failed just doing the descent phase. Because, you know, a landing is really a complicated thing. So that shows you that even if you have kind of unlimited resources like a space agency, a lot of things can go wrong. And another reason why we go for the Apollo 17 side is because it's on the equator. Meaning, on the equator it means a little bit that this is an area where weather, you know, it's, how to put it, it's kind of okay, but it's fluctuating very badly. So if you visit it during daytime, sorry, that's, you can even come closer if you want, I don't know. But if you visit Apollo 17 during daytime, you have plus 125 degrees. So it's like a nice sunny day on the beach, but a little bit too hot, way too hot. However, it's much better than the nighttime, because at the nighttime you have minus 180 degrees. And the problem with the nighttime is that this low temperature really breaks apart all the technology that you have, like the electronics. So, for example, the electronics inside these little guys will not survive minus 180 degrees. So, but you can operate during the daytime. And the good thing about Apollo 17 is that it's a relatively flat area. To give you an opposite example, for example, an area which is more complicated is the polar region. It would make a lot of sense to travel there. The weather is much better there because you have a constant temperature. You don't have temperature fluctuations like you have on the equator. But the problem is that you have only small regions where there is sunlight. And these are regions are permanently illuminated. And all other regions on the poles of the moon are in permanently darkness. And they were talking about darkness which has been there for almost billions of years. Areas which have never seen sunlight, which is kind of really interesting from the science point of view. However, the problem is the areas of sunlight, you know, where you could, for example, go a rover and drive around with a solar panel, and they're really small, they're just 200 meters. So that's something that we're not confident that very early in the beginning of our first attempt to get to, that we can be as accurate as touching down within 200 meters. So that's the reason why we're going to the equator. The problem with the equator is, as I told you, during the day, as it's ups and downs from the temperature, so we will not survive the nighttime. That means we can only use this moon lunar daytime, which is around 14 and a half days long. And the problem is, it's 14 and a half days of sunlight, that the sun in the beginning and at the end is very steep coming over the hills. And the rover has this tilted solar panel, which can be tilted quite drastically without interfering with the wheels. However, still, with the tilting of the solar panel, we cannot use the sunlight during most time of the day. So we have only 11.5 days where we have enough energy to run the mission. So that's the entire mission time. So everything we want to do on it, like experience the rover for Apollo, like, you know, analyzing some craters which are really interesting on the moon, or, you know, by deploying some interesting science experiment, which I'll show you in a second, has to be done in 11.5 minutes. So from the experiment point of view, the mission itself, because, you know, we are kind of scientists and engineers really excited about, you know, learning as much as possible from this mission, is the reason why we have a lot of experiments. A lot of universities there. So just to name a few, we're working with the University of Technical University of Berlin, with the University of Abu Dhabi, for example, the Royal, what's it called, the Royal Society, Royal University of Sweden. And then with a very large Canadian, with the Canadian Space Agency, the US Space Agency, so, and of course the European Space Agency. And what we do with these guys is, we bring a lot of experiments which are in boxes like these to the moon. What you can see here, these white boxes, they're like, as you call them space perceptive, we call them CubeSats. So they're like 10 by 10 by 10 centimeter boxes, and all of the experiments go inside these boxes. They will be placed on the outside. What you can see, there are payload racks, so mountings where all of these boxes can be placed, and then they have the electronics that are attached to it. And in these boxes there are a few things happening. For example, one experiment that we're doing together with the US Space Agency is studying the planned rover behavior of the moon. I know people are now trying, you know, there are movies in the cinema about people growing potatoes on Mars. However, it's not as easy as it sounds or as Hollywood makes it look like. Growing plants in space is actually kind of a big struggle, because plants, if you look at what the research has been done on the ISS, is that they don't grow normally. They have problems with sprouting and then they get disoriented, which is kind of weird to think about being a plant, having a plant being disoriented in space. But the fear, the theory is, from a science perspective, is that really it's kind of the lack of gravity and the lack of the real sunlight, which gives this, which makes it lack a sense of direction. Plant doesn't know where to grow. So that's kind of one of the things that we want to study, for example, with NASA, that we want to grow the first plants on the moon and see how they grow, who they grow, you know, what is different from the moon to the Earth orbit, for example. And of course, you know, down to the surface of Earth. So, yeah, and then of course we have other experiments where we want to study, for example, the gravity of the surface of the moon. And understand, for example, if we can find, just by measuring the gravity, find some surface structures, you know, like, I don't know, like caves below the surface. Yeah, so I don't know, that's kind of a really quick introduction of what we do. But basically what you can see behind me, you know, as I want, you can also set up and come closer a little bit, but you can see the basic thing behind me, that's the Luna spacecraft itself, is kind of what you can see here, this kind of real structure model. This is a Generation 3 prototype. So that means that it's from a structure point of view, even if it looks kind of, how to put it, kind of naked, it really is the full model. Because really the spacecraft itself really consists just of the four main fuel tanks and eight main thrusters. The thrusters that you can see below are the same ones that are being used on the International Space Station to get the astronauts being docked into the station. So they're the same thrusters, so it's really reliable technology. And it's a good thing right now because this is highly commercial. So it's something which is producing a lot of satellites so that we can get it, access to it a little bit cheaper on our mass production. So it's not like that we have to build our own thrusters or that we have to build fuel tanks. It's just something that we can buy off the shelf in space. But there's a lot of things that we have to think about in space. So for example, when you look into the spacecraft, you will see there's a fuel tank just in the middle. So this is this black one. It's a little bit hidden. You can see it below this panel also. And the black fuel tank fastest 400,000 kilometers. However, the problem is, at one point, the fuel tanks, they get more and more empty. So there's a bubble forming inside the fuel tank. A bubble of emptiness, you know, in this case. And the problem is, that what we need to make sure is that the fuel, because the exhaust of the fuel, you know, where it has to go out, is on the bottom side. So, but in space, you have zero gravity. So what we need to make sure is that the fuel always goes out to the end. That is the reason why we use the middle tank as a pressure tank. So we apply pressure from one direction to push the fuel out the other one. Because otherwise, you know, the fluids in space, they would just wobble around. And once you have to imagine, once, that's, it's not air, but let's say a bubble of air, you know, emptiness, comes into the thruster chain, then there would be immediately, I don't know how to call it, the stuff. Sitting in the thruster, you block the thruster immediately. So your engines will die immediately once they run out of fuel. So that's the reason why you need to make sure that the fuel is always even. That's things like these where you kind of have to think about this basically. But one of the cool signs about climate fuels right now is that there's actually all the knowledge is actually really available to you. So what we do is we really work together with all of the guys from NASA and try as best as possible to use things like Wikipedia, you know, existing knowledge, for example, from NASA engineers, to kind of make this technology work in space. And what you can see here, just to give you an example, this is, by the way, one of the images that we never really show in the public, but we also give it around. It shows you how Lina sits inside the rocket. The rocket that we are going to use next year to launch Lina all the way to space, that's a Falcon rocket from SpaceX. SpaceX is a company from Elon Musk, the guy who founded PayPal and Tesla and everything. And the Falcon rocket, it's kind of a very big one. It says, I think, a little over 10 tons of capacity. The Lina, all fueled up, has about 1.2 tons. So most of it is fuel. Thank you very much. Most of it is fuel. So as I told you, 980 liters is fuel. The rest is structure. So Lina itself only weighs 330 kilograms with both rovers, with two rovers, all of the equipment, fully equipped, but without fuel, of course. So that's actually really, really lightweight for a spacecraft. So you can carry it around in your hand. Not that I would recommend it. And the point is that means that we don't need the entire rocket. So what we do is we reserve, of course, an entire rocket for us, but what we do is we just put a Lina into the top side of the rocket, the upper side of it, and there's a commercial space satellite sitting below us. And the destination of the satellite below us, they actually, this is an Earthbound satellite, and we want to go to the moon, so at one point we have to depart our ways, but we're kind of traveling all the way up to it. So I have no idea how well you can hear me. I'm really kind of trying my best there, but that's kind of try to loosen it up a little bit. So what would help me is kind of, if you could ask me some questions, you know, any kind of what comes to your mind about this mission, and really, you know, even silly stuff is okay. Because somebody, you know, I think somebody earlier asked why there's so much Kapton cake on it, you know, the golden stuff here. And the real answer is really this, because Kapton, I think you might be familiar with it from your homes, for example. It's the same stuff that you can see on your heating units, you know, or for example, at refrigerators at the back end, you know, you always look at the front side, but on the back side, you'll see this stuff. And this is a thermal tape, which is it's basically like duct tape for space. So, you know, we use it, of course, so that the edges are not that sharp, which is kind of helpful. And then none of these internal particles, because there's always some particles in there, that they don't fall out so easily. Other than this, it really looks nice. That's also a good part of it. But in the end, for example, what you will not see right now, the Lina will not look like this when it goes through. It will be fully packed. What you can see here, this is MLI. That's the same stuff that you have in your trunk of a car, for example. And you're actually supposed to have it. It's a mandatory requirement. So this is a foil which protects the thermal layer, for example. That is the reason why all spacecraft, all fuel components of space, they're always wrapped in this golden foil. And all technical components, like this little guy, are coated in white. So white also is a special thing, because the color white, when used in space, it's a special silicon white. which reflects the sunlight. And something which I almost forgot about. So what you can see there, you can take them in your hands. The entire technology what we have is based out of 3D printed material. This is a specific material that we've developed together with the guys from Audi. This is 3D printed aluminum. And you will see it's just 1 millimeter thick, so it's hollow on the inside. And you can see it even better on this wheel, because it's, even the fins of the wheel itself are hollow. So it's less than a millimeter. It's very strong, very lightweight, and it's a mixture of aluminum, magnesium, and silicon. So it's really cool. So you have to imagine how can you produce, first of all, how can you actually produce 3D printed parts like these? And you know, the entire rover, even though it's coated, you cannot see it when it's coated. They look kind of like cheap plastic parts, kind of, you know, the same material. But the point is, how do you produce them? You take a bed of powder, really big chamber, you fill it up with the powder, you mix the powder the way that you want. It's like creating your own coffee plant, you know. So you apply a certain number of magnesium, a certain number of aluminum, mix it together, and then you have 6 different lasers which melt the soil layer by layer by layer, constructing the car. That means you can create inside structures. For example, what you can also do, I don't know where that up at, but with this part, for example, this, I don't know how to call it, you know. Yeah, but this big part, for example, that shows you, if you look into it, you will see that you have hollow structures here. So cable routings, this is for the camera head. So it's like this part over here. And you can see that the cabling can go directly through it. So the cameras, the cable come out of here and they go all the way to the bottom. So that's something which you cannot do with classical manufacturing. You cannot create hollow structures. So that's really helpful for us. That reduces the number of parts and again makes the material stronger. That was something you have to understand. When we started with this project 9 years ago, this technology did not exist. That is something which really was kind of invented along the way, and we started to be the first ones to ever use it in this way. And it will, I think, take many, many years till it ends up in the daily operations, you know, in your daily life. But it's really cool from the technology point of view. Yeah, of course.
Can you talk about
the
social media space?
Yes, where is she? Hey. Yeah, she will take over in a second because she's really great at social media. Not a problem, but that's a
secret. Ask the technical question. Yeah. How do you know that the
moon rover is still there? That's a good question. Yeah, okay. So, just to recap, the question was how do we know that the moon rover from Apollo is still on the surface of the moon? So, at Apollo, you know, the rover, of course, has been parked there 45 years ago. And what NASA did like 4 years ago, what maybe Kate will also mention a little bit, is they did a space mission, which was called the LRO, the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. So this one flew around the moon and took pictures of it. And the LRO also took a very high resolution picture of the Apollo 17 landing site. And the problem is, you know, a very high resolution from orbit still is very kind of blurry. So what you can see over, you can see 4 pixels like this. It's a very large picture. But in these 4 pixels, you can actually see that the antenna, and there's some image of the rover there, that the antenna that the rover has is still pointing towards the Earth. So it's kind of still standing upright. It's not falling together.
Okay. I was wondering, is there a problem just to fly to the moon, landing next to the NASA's lunar rover?
Oh, you mean like a political problem?
Yeah, like
yeah, of course, totally.
Okay,
that's a question that comes very often. So do we have to ask for permission to fly to the moon? First of all, the answer is yes, we have to ask for permission. And for many different sites, it's very complicated and nobody really knows anything concrete. You know, we have to actually ask, you know, from the German perspective, the what is called the Luftfahrtbundesamt. And you know, we gave these guys a call and asked, you know, we want to do a mission to the moon, and they were like, what? We sent them all the info and they're like, guys, what should we do with all of this information? You know, we were like, yeah, give us a permit to fly to the moon. And they were like, yeah, but who are we to forbid it? We're like, I don't know, but you know, there's an international charter which says we have to ask you for permission. And they were looking into it and we're like, okay, from their understanding, they don't see any reason to forbid us going to do. So why shouldn't we do it so they allow us? So that's the good, that's the German side. So then we went to the US side, and the US side, they have the FAA, the Federal Aviation Authority, or yeah, I think that's called, or agency, I don't know what the last A stands for. So FAA, and the FAA did the very same thing. However, their thing is that they're also looking a little bit into if we want to do, they have to watch out that we don't do anything bad, that we don't harm other beings. So the point is, nobody's living on the moon, at least that I'm aware of, so it's really hard for us to harm somebody being on the moon. So the point is, the only thing that we have to kind of coordinate a little bit is that we don't damage the Apollo landing site. However, there's no jurisdiction to forbid it to us. We have to think about it this, because there's a very big question, who owns the moon? Does the Apollo landing site, is it being owned by NASA? Not really. NASA has published, and we've worked with them since 2009 very, very closely. They published a set of guidelines. It's almost 200 pages. Okay, 200 pages PDF on what to do when you approach the moon and you're close at the Apollo landing site, how to behave. So and it's very kind of the simple answer is simply that we are really careful, that we work closely with NASA. So for example, we coordinate everywhere we want to go, all the driving, all the tracks, and we're really slow when we approach the landing site. And at the very last meters before we get close to the Apollo goal, we will have to ride zigzag. You know? Zigzag for one reason, because NASA is afraid that if we drive straight forward and something goes wrong, the rover could continue to drive forward and, you know, drive down
and destroy their rubbish they left there. Destroy the rubbish they left there.
Yeah, of course.
All right.
So, but long story short, let's say NASA would say we're not okay with you going back there. And there's theoretically speaking nothing they can do. However, you know, I want to do some visit to the US in the sometime soon. So, and I think that you will probably really get pretty soon arrested if you screw with the United States in this case. So, it always is really important to be nice, and we don't want to damage anything. So, our perspective, we really want to analyze and study, and we do it in a, what's the term, non-manipulative way. That's the robotics term. So we don't want to manipulate anything. We just have sensors and info. We have spectral camera, for example. We do some infrared analysis. We have, you know, this gravimeter, for example. So all the analysis that we do is without touching or modifying things.
So the connecting question, will the pictures you will tell me?
Okay. So that's a very good question. So how's the availability of the data? So this is a private mission. Private also means like commercial. So technically speaking, with all of the data that we could do whatever we want. You know, we could take all the pictures, we could all the telemetry, and we could sell it to the highest bidder, whatever. However, this is not who we are, nor what we want to do, because we are scientists and engineers, and this is the first time that we're doing a mission. And we can only do this because of all the information which is available around the world. You know, due to things like Wikipedia, due to the NASA archives, which publish everything under open data, even the European Space Agency, just, I think, over a year ago, started publishing everything under Creative Commons. So, only due to this is possible what we do. That is the reason why we decided for the very first mission to publish all the data, all the footage, all telemetry, all scientific output under Creative Commons as well. So that means everybody can use it, even for commercial purposes, and you can use it for your master thesis, whatever you want. So that's the good thing. I think that future missions, and I know from the US side, for example, there are some private American companies who also want to go back to the moon, I don't know when, but sometime. And they're actually selling their data. They're paying quite a lot, for example. One company sold their landing telemetry, just the sensor values during the descent. They sold it to NASA already, not flying, now for $20 million. So it shows you the value of scientific data. Because for NASA, you know, it's kind of interesting to get as much data as possible for the end. But for our end, we think it's much better that if you do something, that you do it the way that it has been always been done, so that others can build up on it. But of course, you know, we have a long-term commercial thinking. We have to point this out. Because what you can see, these experiments over there, a good number of them is being commercially sold. So universities come to us and actually pay us money so that we take the experiments to the moon. And to give you some numbers for it, we do the calculation based on the mass, because it's kind of the best factor that you can use in space. The size, not so much actually. And 1 kilogram of instrument simple. We put some connectors behind it, and we give them the downlink, and then we coordinate power usage. So it's a 28-volt system, and then just coordinate it. What we don't do is that we enforce any arbitrary requirements on the guys, because why? We just sit down and talk with them and see what is the experiment, what they are trying to achieve, and then we try to make the best arrangement as possible. Of course, we don't let them use up all our data that we have, of course. So, yeah, any tip there?
More boring side of it, but you mentioned, you know, funding and how you finance the whole thing, and you also have some brands involved.
Yes. Yeah, we have two commercial main sponsors for this mission. So this mission is sponsored by Audi, you know, the car company, and by Vodafone, the telecommunication company.
Have they been involved from the beginning?
No. It was a lot of work for me to get sponsors excited for this thing. You know, because you have to, first of all, convince them that you're not crazy. So this is what we managed to do together with the DLR, the German Space Agency. They helped us a lot with it. And the Audi guys, actually, they're helping us with the rover, for example, so that is where they have a lot of know-how. So what we always wanted to do, I never wanted to have a sponsor like, you know, like Coca-Cola, which just gives you a logo and nothing else and a lot of money. You know, money is nice, but the problem is that it's much better to have somebody who's actually involved in what you do, who really cares about what you do. So that is the reason why we wanted to have technical partners. And you know, Audi, of course, they take care of a lot of the drives, and for Vodafone it's something really nice, something more recently that we announced. So they're both. Audi is on board for 3.5 years now, Vodafone for less than a year right now. And with Vodafone we're doing something really nice, because we want to bring LTE to the moon. Really the standard LTE technology. And it's intentional, the standard. It means that the Alenia spacecraft itself becomes a base station. And we use the LTE link as a low power, high bandwidth, surface-to-surface communication link between the rover and the landing module, and then we do the relay of the signal from the lander to Earth. Because Alenia, once it's landed, it has 400 watts of power, which it does not have any use for, because it needs a lot of power for all of the valves doing descent. They take a lot of energy because they're electromagnetic. So the electromagnetic power valves. So, but once it's landed, it doesn't need the power, so we can use all this power for communication. So we have a very high bandwidth link down to Earth. And then we can have a very wide range LTE network on the moon, which, and if you think about LTE from the smartphone, you have a very small chip, like it's the size of a penny, which is the lock-in chip for you going onto the network, and you have a 2-centimeter antenna. What do you get out of it? You get megabits, up to over 100 megabits of bandwidth, over 15 kilometers. That's what your telephone actually can do, if you think about it. That's LTE. So LTE is quite cool for this purpose. And on the moon, there's not so much interference because nobody is there. And the point is about using standard technology. Why is this so important? Using standard technology means that everybody else can build up on it. It's not proprietary. Yes, thank you. So like a self-developing. And it's not meant to be bad. You know, if NASA, for example, were to solve the same challenge, then they would probably go out and develop the NASA Space Link, which would be the most awesome communication link that you can ever think about. Totally optimized, perfect, and then 10 years later ESA would come along and would develop the ESA Space Link, because they love the NASA Space Link, but they think they can do it better. So you have two different communication standards, and then a commercial company comes out and says, we need a communication link, and they look at both solutions and think, oh my god, they're totally over-engineered, let's take a simpler solution, and then develop a new one, and then they have like three standards. That's not how everything works. If it worked for this, then the internet wouldn't exist. So, and the point is, you know, that with LTE means basically that is the same thing that you have in your smartphone. You can simply just check in, and then you can use any standard device. So it's a very technology based on the billions of existing devices. So it's kind of really interesting that it does that you have a standard technology in space.
And when are you launching? What's
Mid next year, that's the most. Same side as the Apollo, as the Apollo program. So the launch side is Cape Canaveral.
Are you developing all of that here within?
Mostly, but it's quite mixed. So we're building much of the technology. If we're in Ingolstadt, Neckarsulm, Salzburg, prior to this a lot in Hamburg, and now a lot of most everything is centered in Berlin. We have a very nice site where you can come around and visit us. It's a campus of 2,200 square meters where we are building these spacecrafts and rovers and everything. We just moved in. We had an open house day 4 weeks ago or so.